Hello, my name is Payam Haidari. I'm a professor of electrical engineering at the University of California, Irvine. This lecture gives a brief overview of millimeter wave and terahertz integrated circuits in silicon technologies, challenges, and solutions. There are a number of applications for the emerging millimeter wave and terahertz frequency band. Some of the applications are indicated in this slide, including the automotive short-range and long-range radars, short-range gigabit per second wireless communication, passive and active imaging, and terahertz imaging and spectroscopy. The millimeter wave and terahertz frequency band for wireless communication enables very high data rate communications. And this high data rate communication is inspired by the well-known channel theory of channel capacity. According to the channel theory, the channel capacity, C, is directly proportional to the signal bandwidth and has a logarithmic relationship with the signal-to-noise ratio. Now, the use of very high carrier frequency around millimeter wave and terahertz frequency makes it possible to increase the bandwidth while maintaining the small fractional bandwidth. And the small fractional bandwidth is really the bandwidth normalized by the carrier frequency. So what it means here is that I can increase the bandwidth, and as a result, I can increase the maximum data rate, which makes it possible to send and transmit multi-gigabit per second data. At the same time, operation at very high frequencies means that the passive devices, including inductors, antennas, when they are designed on chip, their effective footprint will become smaller and smaller. And shown here is two examples in which the left one shows a dimicro photograph of a dipole antenna with an effective length, two antennas with effective, each with effective length of 740 micron and with a spacing of only 820 micron. And in the right is a four element phase array transmitter, which was presented in ISSC 2013. As you can see, and if you look at the dimicro photograph of this chip, we can identify four slot loop antenna over a very small area of only 2.2 millimeter by 2.2 millimeter. What it means here is that I can accommodate more antenna elements. As a result, I can increase the radiation, I can increase the output power over only a small footprint of a chip area. Another application which one can think for the millimeter wave and terahertz is on the imaging applications. For example, the imaging application in the domain of the passive imaging, where in which the black body radiated by the materials can be detected by a receiver, which we call a passive receiver. For example, shown here is a schematic of a passive receiver comprising an antenna, a power detector, and a baseband amplifier and integrator. Now, previously, this design or this block diagram can only be designed in very advanced technologies. But due to the technology scaling, together with invention of a number of cool techniques, we can design on-chip passive imaging receivers. For example, shown here is a representation of single element passive imaging receiver, where the heterodyne architecture has been used in order to design a one element imaging receiver. And then due to this simplicity, with a small change, we can increase this number of elements, and as a result, we can design a focal plane array architecture with many antenna, with many imaging elements. And the fact that the transistors are very small, the on-chip antenna, as a result of going to what higher frequency is very small, makes it possible to design this focal plane array over a very small chip area. So one important question is that why silicon technology is used or is favorable for designing these highly sophisticated systems. Shown in the right is a comparison between different technologies in terms of their cutoff frequency with respect to the gate length or effective channel length. And as it appears here in this plot, as the gate length gets smaller and smaller, the cutoff frequency of the silicon MOSFET transistor gets very, increasingly closer to the maximum operation frequency of a compound semiconductor, in this case, an indium phosphide HEMT transistor. So what it means here is that some of the applications that have been under the territory of compound semiconductor now can be used in a more common commercial silicon process. And at the same time, we can basically design sophisticated system comprising many array of detectors and radiators on a single chip. And a very good representation of this multi-antenna element is a paper which was presented at the ISSCC 2013, in which the authors presented a highly complex 94 gigahertz four-element phase array transmitter receiver on a single chip. And as I mentioned, the fact that the transistors are getting smaller, we can design a very sophisticated multi-antenna element system on a single die. Despite the fact that the millimeter wave and terahertz frequency provides us with a number of potential advantages, there are a number of challenges that need to be addressed before these integrated circuits can be fully utilized. For example, as we increase the frequency toward maximum operation frequency, we cannot really design very high amplifier with very small or low noise figure. Also, the maximum output power and the efficiency are not that high at very high frequencies. Also, there is one important notion which is really coming from the nature or governed by the nature, which is the free space path loss in directly proportional to the square value of the frequency. What it means here is that as I increase the frequency, the maximum distance between the transmitter and receiver is decreased very fast with frequency. And this means that some of the applications of very high frequencies are only limited to short-range communication. And if we want to increase the distance a little bit, we have to basically boost the power by using many number of antenna elements. Also, on-chip antenna is a very interesting feature that it can be added to the fully integrated system or transmitter receiver, for example. However, its gain and radiation efficiency is not sufficient. And finally, for signal sources designed on-chip at very high frequencies, the phase noise might be high and the tuning range might not be very very wide. So there are a number of solutions that have recently been presented that addresses the lack of amplification. For example, we can basically design the transistor stages or amplification stages such that we can basically bring the transistors almost, or the amplification stages almost close to the border of their stability. And then if they design these amplifiers very carefully, then we can boost the gain of these amplifiers. And shown here is an example of a three-stage power amplifier at 210 gigahertz frequency presented in ISSCC 2013, in which the authors use the so-called over-neutralization technique to boost the gain of each amplification stage so as to achieve higher gain. As for the solutions to low antenna gain and low radiation efficiency, one interesting idea that have been examined and it can be implemented very well in a silicon platform is the use of massive multi-antenna transmitters and receivers basically using that incorporate special power combining. And what this special power combining does is that by using many antenna elements on chip And by transmitting the signals coherently, we can basically achieve high output power by combining this output power, especially in the free space. And as a result, mitigate the insufficient antenna gain and the power gain of the on-chip power amplifiers and the on-chip antennas. And an example of a four-element IQ transmitter receiver has been is shown here, which was presented in ISSC 2013. Also, as solutions for the limited output power, once again, suggest the use of array of synchronized signal sources, where each signal source incorporates harmonic generator and multiplication circuitry in order to boost the frequency. And then by using these harmonic generators and by synchronizing these harmonic generators on chip, we are able to increase the maximum output power. And an example of this technique is shown here, where 16 element resonators and radiators have been designed together and synchronized together to achieve a very good high output power. And a paper based on this idea was presented in ISSC 2014. And finally, as I mentioned, the tuning range and the phase noise might not be good enough at very high frequencies. Now, one suggestion is always to use the closed loop signal sources, or based on the PLLs or phase lock loops, to lower the phase noise, particularly the phase noise close to the center frequency, which we call closing phase noise, and and increase the tuning range. And in designing this closed loop frequency synthesizer, if we can co-design and co-optimize critical high frequency building block together, then we can further optimize the performance. And an example based on this co-designing and co-optimizing of these high frequency elements is shown here, where a frequency synthesizer operating at 300 gigahertz based on the phase locking technique, it has been presented in ISSC 2014. In summary, the vastly underutilized spectrum in sub-terahertz band enables a number of disruptive applications. Applications such as 10 plus gigabit chip-to-chip wireless communication, imaging and spectroscopy. Owing to aggressive technology scaling of both feature size and the operation frequency, the nanoscale silicon process might be a good platform for designing very high frequency sophisticated systems, such as array of dense detectors and radiators, phase arrays, massive MIMO transmitters and receivers with many number of elements. High frequency requirement imposes a number of challenges both at the architecture and the circuit design at very high frequencies. And in this talk, I provided an overview of some of the challenges and some directions that hopefully solve some of these challenging problems at very high frequencies. Thank you.